Hi everyone, welcome back to another Godot benchmark video. Today we are putting Godot's physics system to the test using this test bench tool I made. If you are interested in trying it out yourself, links are in the description. For those of you in a hurry, here's the result. Of course, without context, the benchmark result is just a number and doesn't tell the whole story. Stick around and I'll break down these numbers, explain how I get them, why I tested things this way, why I test them in different physics frame rate, and why I mark some of the results unstable. The last two questions are actually quite related. In the Godot physics system, there's a glitch. When you try to stack a bunch of bodies, they will fall into an unstable state and spiral out of control. According to the Godot documentation, this can be solved by cranking up the physics frame rate, which I conveniently have here for easy access. I've also found out that the circle shape seems to be much more resistant to the glitch than the square shape. Just keep in mind, the default value for the physics frame rate of 60 should work just fine for most games. The glitch only happens when the game is cramming a massive amount of intercolliding bodies together at a low physics frame rate. Now let's talk about the slip mechanic in the physics system. In this scenario, after all the circles have been spawned, we can see that the frame rate is just above 10 frames per second. After a while, the number jumps to nearly 1000 frames per second. This is because when the bodies are not moving, it goes into a slip state. This slip mechanic is pretty common on the major game engines with physics. Back to the scenario, if we turn off the visual, we can see that the frame rate is now above 2000. That is almost the frame rate we get without anything spawned. So in Godot, when the bodies are in a slip state, they don't mess with your game's performance much. I found out that there is an option to turn off the slip for the rigid bodies, but it seems that even with that off, when the object stops moving, the frame rate still jumps around. The inconsistent frame rate is making it very hard for me to take down the numbers. That's why we have this bob button and the fountain mode toggle here, which allows us to test the frame rate when the bodies are moving. However, they don't always work, and the frame rate is still all over the place. I've done hundreds of tests, and the numbers I recorded are useless because when I ran the test again, I got a completely different number. So, as I was too tired of running tests manually, I decided to implement automated testing. Here's how it works. The test bench will spawn a rigid body every X frames, and when the frame rate drops below a certain point, it will stop and tell us how many rigid bodies it spawned. By spawning every X frame instead of every X milliseconds, it allows the spawn rate to slow down when the frame rate is getting low. With this setup, I can finally get consistent results. Now, back to the results. We can see that you can spawn a lot more circles than squares, as you don't have to increase the physics frame rate too much. I've also tried running the test using physics server and rendering server according to the optimization guide in the documentation. The result shows performance improvements ranging from 12% to 24%. Now, let's take a look at 3D physics. The testing method is pretty much the same, so I won't bore you with the details. The only thing to note is that the unstable glitch in 3D only shows up when you set a super low physics frame rate. The default 60 frame rate is good enough for our test. Oh, and by the way, Jolt doesn't have this issue, even at low frame rates. Alright, here's the result. It's very obvious that using Jolt gave us a significant performance boost. It's up to 286% more rigid body spawn compared to the default Godot physics engine. We can also see that although the default engine got a slight boost from the server optimization, the Jolt engine actually got a much more improvement from it. However, before you go and add Jolt to your game, keep in mind that there are limitations of it. It doesn't support Android and iOS yet, which might be a deal breaker for some game devs. Another thing I noticed is that we can spawn more spheres than cubes. That means that the physics engine can handle spheres better. However, when I run the same test on a laptop, the visible cube test actually outperforms the visible sphere test. It makes sense as it's harder to render a sphere than a cube due to the complexity in its mesh. I do have a dedicated GPU on my desktop, so the test did not run into a GPU bottleneck. Here's a quick recap for the video. Most games won't run into the unstable glitch, but if you do, crank up the physics frame rate. Squares and cubes are much more susceptible to the glitch compared to circles and spheres. When not moving, physics objects go to sleep and they hardly use up any CPU power. The physics engine can handle more circles and spheres than squares and cubes. However, rendering sphere mesh is harder than cubes. You can get a significant performance improvement by optimizing using servers. Jolt is generally better than the default Godot 3D physics engine, but be aware of its limitations. This benchmark is mostly for fun and a way for me to get familiar with the Godot engine. After playing around with Godot for a while now, I really want to start making games with it. My plan is to port a half-done VR project from Unity and start from there. If that sounds interesting, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out. Don't forget to leave a like for this video if you enjoyed watching it. Alright, that's all for this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.